process.
Okay, thank you. All right, this afternoon, this is the committee meeting of the Fairfax County History Commission. It's the African American History Initiative Committee, and we're meeting beginning at 2:30 today. So I'm going to read the motions that we have to go through. To conduct this meeting wholly electronically, the committee needs to make certain findings for the record to evidence our compliance with all applicable laws. These motions address this compliance. First, I'm going to conduct a roll call and ask each member participating in the meeting to state your name and your location. I ask that each of you pay close attention to ensure that you can hear each of your colleagues. And I'll start with myself, Phyllis Walker Ford, committee co-chair. Mary Lipsey.
Mary Lipsey in Springfield. Mary Lipsey in Springfield.
Okay. Barbara Nave.
Barbara Nave in Reston.
Tammy Marino.
Manorino in Mount Vernon.
Ann Stuntz.
Ann
is there.
Vienna, Virginia. You hear me?
Yeah.
Something happened. I'll come back to Ann.
Yes.
Oh.
Okay.
Now we do.
Testing, 1, 2, 3.
Ann, say your name again.
Ann Stuntz, Vienna, Virginia.
Thank you. Esther McCullough. Jordan Chinnenbaum. Cheryl Rapetti.
Cheryl Rapetti, Sully District.
Sue Kovac Schumann.
Sue Kovac Schumann, Mantua, with Tiger.
Lynn Gavi Hodge. Liz Crowell.
Liz Crowell, Alexandria.
Christopher Barbashak.
Chris Barbashak, City of Fairfax.
David Meyer.
This is David Meyer in the City of Fairfax.
Carol Herrick.
Carol Herrick, McLean.
Okay, and Denise Drissel is going to be joining us later on. Okay, at this point, I will pass the gavel to Barbara Nave.
Thank you.
So that I may make the motion, the appropriate motion. I move that the AAHI committee certify for the record that each member's voice may be adequately heard by each other member of this board.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Second, the need for electronic meeting. Second, I move that the committee certify that the state of emergency caused by the COVID-19 pandemic makes it unsafe for this commission, for this committee and the public to physically attend this meeting in person, and the usual procedures cannot be implemented safely or practically. As a result, I further move that the committee conduct this meeting electronically through a dedicated video audio conferencing line, and that the public may access this meeting by calling 1-844-621-3956 and entering access code 173-389-0084.
Second.
Okay. Oh, for this part, we didn't have to make a motion.
No.
Okay, wait, I'm sorry. Yes, we do. So we have a second. All in favor of this motion?
Aye.
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 Thank you. Any opposed? No. Okay, third, Finally, I move that the committee certify that the matters on its agenda today relate to the COVID-19 emergency itself are necessary for continuing in Fairfax County government and/or are statutorily required or necessary to continue operations and the discharge of the committee's lawful purposes, duties, and responsibilities.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right, and the motion passes.
Here's your gavel.
I'll get the gavel back from Barbara.
There you go.
Thank you.
Welcome.
All right. We have two items that we're going to discuss today. And the first is final discussion on our template. And we have two samples that were sent out just a few minutes before the meeting today. Both have basically the same information.
Were there two samples? I only saw, maybe I didn't look hard enough. There were two files. One was
there are two attachments.
The minutes.
Yeah. The one file starts off with the March minutes, and then page two of the March minutes is a template.
Right.
Oh, okay, I missed that.
Yeah, I tried to note it in the last sentence of the little note that I sent out. And that one
just,
is
just reading too
that,
fast, sorry.
That one is the one that starts with African-American template suggested example. And that's the one that Mary had put in with the March minutes. It has the district, the date, title, category, description, location, and notes. And then the second one is the one that Barbara suggested, which is it's African American History Inventory Research Guide for Research Cultural Resources. So that was actually the second attachment for today.
I was going to say they have some similarities between the two of them. I'm just kind of comparing.
Yeah, right. So I think if we can agree on both have very, very much the same thing. So if we can agree on the fact that we would want the date, the district, the title, category.
Mm-hmm. And I assume it's going to be in a table format like we had the Confederate names inventory, and then it sort of doesn't matter what comes first because you can search on any column in your table.
Yeah, I couldn't build a table, so I was trying to go through. That's why it's like it is. So the district, oh, yeah. There's been a question whether we should include the district, and I think so because it's a good search. And then if the community name and then the others, you need a community name presumably and the location and identifying what it is. Whether it's a resource, whether it's records. In some communities, you'll have all of it. In some, you may have, you know, a community that's just a memory. You may have a marker, or you may have, it would be just a church, something like that. So trying to organize it a little bit for whatever we put out as our research guide.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
I'm a big fan of tables as long as we can all use them once given the template. Are you okay using a table, Barbara?
Because yeah, I agree it needs to be a table. I was just giving you the information this morning.
Yeah, seems to me we can just kind of blend them for anything that the table forgot. We can add what Barbara put on the list. What do you think?
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a good idea.
We the trepidation on districts is we do anticipate some redrawing, but that we could have, this is like probably more like the Confederate names inventory. It's a moment. We're doing it now. So we'll write the district that it is now, and it could be adjusted at some point by some nice intern somewhere.
Well, who knows when that's going to happen? And that's, you know,
they keep talking about it.
Let them talk.
Well, and I mean, it's just like things have happened in the past. Like, I know to look in Lee District for some things that, you know, because it isn't a hard line between Lee and Mount Vernon, you know, one side of the road versus the other, you know, the community is really both.
That's right.
You guys, I walk across my street and I am in Providence. I don't even know if it's the median or just to the road, which.
Okay, so it sounds like we're pretty much all in agreement.
So really, if you look at Barbara's list, it really is just each of these things. Title is name, maybe. Location is location. Yeah. They're very compatible.
And instead of title, I just called it the community name is what we're. Mm-hmm. Even if it's a community of two, whatever. And I thought about the associated family names in some instances. I think of like Carrollton, and it just giving, as Tammy says, if the bits of information that you have, then it would be a lot easier to search, right?
Mm-hmm. That's true.
It's developed.
Barbara? This is Mary. I haven't had a chance to look at it, and I'm afraid to go off the screen and then have to come back in to look. So
I didn't send it to you because you were supposed to be resting.
Oh, now. You didn't send it to me. Okay, well then that's why I haven't.
I'm sorry.
My only concern is there will be some that I think will not have a district. For example, the oral history example that I gave of Dennis Howard, he talked of all sorts of districts, but he was interviewed for a Braddock district project. So, you know, I would assume I could put Braddock district, but if people are looking for Braddock district history, they're going to get more than Braddock district with his interview.
Well, so, then you could come up with, I mean, that certainly is a point. And Phyllis and I talked about the example is with Naomi's collection, because much of it's Mason, but she also has materials there that were not Mason. So you either note in a different district, see such and such, or have a place where you can make a note. So
yeah,
okay. I'm certainly there'll be situations like that. Yeah,
I actually need a catch-all.
Pardon me?
Yeah, we need a catch-all overall section for the things that apply to more than one.
I mean, I just wrote in multiple.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, for mm-hmm. district. So I did a kind of little test run of the May. I guess this is Barbara's, the one that we're talking about. So, you know, district for one of them, one was it's a book on historic sites significant to Black community in Fairfax County. And so the district there was multiple. And then under community names, I mentioned all of the different community
there
names that were mentioned. And then associated family names, and listed all of the family names that were mentioned. And then the title of the book under written records, mm-hmm. and then a brief paragraph describing it. So mm-hmm. I actually sent that to you and Mary, to Phyllis and Mary, to show you sort of just like what it looked like and whether or not I was using it correctly and whether that seemed to be, you know, I mean, in both cases, like, you know, another one was a Sully District article. And there, because it was specifically about Sully Historic Site, an enslaved person associated with the Sully Historic Site. So there I have an address, a founding date, the Lee names, as well as,
right.
You know, and then standing resource, I note, you know, Sully is there.
Well, then it works. A little
bit. Yeah, I think might. Yeah.
You know, when you're when you're trying to visualize this, until you put the real hard things in there, you aren't sure. So
right. Yeah, which is why I sort of like, oh, let's give it a little test drive.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Right. Yeah. And like the example that I thought of that's overarching is like, you know, for instance, the yearbooks from Luther Jackson High School.
Yes.
You know, that mm-hmm. applies to the whole county. It's not just, you know, where Luther Jackson.
Right. Yeah. Good point. Right. Yeah. Right.
And Mary has a collection of things that people have been sending in, and even what, yeah. what she's doing that are across the county rather than right. specific.
Yeah,
district. So yeah, we could use the same format and just note it that it's multiple. Like Naomi had in Naomi's collection, which is in the Virginia room, she has some oral history interviews, and some of them are in her Mason district, and then others are in Mount Vernon district because she has Gladys Bushrod and some others from Shiloh Baptist Church.
Chris, you're the archival librarian. What do you think?
I think everything looks good. I don't think there's really much else I can add to it. I think it is, you're right. I mean, it is complicated where, what do you do with, for example, Luther Jackson High School, where, yeah, it's based in Merrifield, but there's just so many other places and districts related to it. So yeah, like it's kind of complicated.
Right. Yeah.
The other thing I was thinking is that my neighbors don't even know what district they live in. So I don't know if there's any way we could put a little map at the beginning or a general description. I don't know, because I can remember being at community meetings and somebody, you know, their homeowners meetings, and somebody said something about Braddock District, and they said, well, what is that? You know, these are people who have lived in our community like 10 years, you know, so, and I thought, well, they must never voted for their supervisors. So I don't know. I mean, I know we didn't do it for Confederate
David.
Names.
Look at David. There's David.
There you go.
But I don't know if it's important. If you have the location, hopefully they could search by location, you know, and maybe don't worry about it.
Well, that's why, yeah, and maybe you could put, would it help to say magisterial district, or would that confuse them even more?
I don't think it would help.
What that means.
It's not going to help.
Well, it's pretty easy for the county to just put the entire county on a website, draw the lines, and then you run a cursor over it, or you can just type in your address and it will tell you who's, what the name of the district is, who your supervisor is. And this is the only reason I put this up is this is the city of Fairfax.
Right.
We have 6 precincts. They're just, the precincts are irrelevant, really. They're just voting locations. But, you know, this is just an idea of what the county could also do. And interestingly, the General Assembly of Virginia has already done this. So you can go to their website and just type in Ann Stunts, Merry-Go-Round, Chainbridge Road, 22180 or 1, right? And it will tell you what district you're in, who your supervisor is, their email address, their phone number, it has it all there. So the county ought to do that at some point.
The county does have a map.
Well,
what you showed, yeah. So it's there, but it's a matter of plugging that information in and making it interactive.
Correct. Yeah. Correct. I know. That's exactly right.
But I do like the way I have used and used the Find Your District feature on the website. I would get a million of those monopole and communication tower thing. All they would do is give you an address, and you had to figure out which of you commission members mm-hmm. to direct it to. I was kept, and so if we have an address, and we will, even if the community is generic, like Bailey's Crossroads, there will be some specific addresses in that, so people can. Yeah, people can find it. And ultimately, you know, we've talked about how somebody's going to end up with a beautiful map of all this where you
click on all these things and find all those files and interesting information, hopefully.
So if we have the map, we could take off the district in the template and just, it's at some point in the final, when we are ready to release it, we would have a map that shows the different areas. So as long as there's an address or location.
Yeah.
But some of these might not have an address. I mean, you know, like if it's a, I don't know, let's say it's a story about a person. It wouldn't necessarily have a specific address associated with it.
Or book, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, I mean, it might have a community name, and you can link, you can find the community based on a map, certainly.
Okay.
Well, Cheryl, what I did for the oral history is actually tell the person online, where is that oral history? So it's not a physical address, it's the link to read the oral history.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So, and that's the way I interpreted location. If this is an oral URL. History, yeah, you know, is if it's in the Virginia Room, is it a vertical file or is it, you know, a link on the web or whatever? So that's the actual location of the oral history, okay. The transcript.
Right. Okay. So for books and journal articles and the like, we should be noting where the which library it's physically.
Well, in. If it's just Fairfax County Public Libraries, that's all they need, because they can go to the catalog to get that. But I, you know, if it's Library of Virginia or something like that, mm-hmm. then yes, that would be helpful.
Well, and if you, I think that's what I meant when I get down here to written records, the type of records and the repository would be where you would find them.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Maybe too indirect, but when I put location or address, I was talking about the actual, the community, the remnants of the community or the community itself.
Right.
I was talking about the physical place.
Yeah.
So we'd have to.
It's such a mixed bag of types of things we're doing. We're going to rely a lot on the section called notes and short paragraphs.
Right.
Yes.
That was sort of like the Fibber McGee part of it.
I think you were very right on that.
Well, and I'm running into, because I'm writing like a how-to, you know, how-to search. And so I did the historical newspaper index, you know, the Fairfax Herald, Alexandria Gazette, using every word that I could think of that a citizen might use to look up about African Americans. And I am just amazed at what I'm finding. And so I don't know if I should take it a step further, and because I had never heard of the Colored Citizens Association and the Negro League, and there's a couple other things. So I don't know if I should take it a step further or just let citizens hunt and peck, or just say, you know, these are examples of headlines that you can find, you know, with this topic.
Oh, I think examples are great. That's a great way to steer them and just, you know, raise awareness of those.
Okay. Because I found, you know, the county fair, which I knew about, but there's some.
I knew about that, yeah.
I did not know about the, and they call it the Colored Citizens Association, and there's multiple communities are having meetings. Mm-hmm. Of it.
Mm. And, could you adapt? Now this is the danger when we do this, but like with community name, is there another way of saying the community would be the Colored Citizens Association? That would be the group, and then go from there. If you were listening,
make a template. Yeah, because I mean,
from there.
But I think Mary's describing like a finding aid that she's writing up for,
you know,
for looking into
which could
newspaper articles.
Right.
Which could be a section in whatever our final product is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, what I can do is, for the first thing I could do is just add it to the searches that I have there,
mm-hmm.
you know, for them. because if you've ever navigated that historical newspaper index, sometimes you're very lucky and sometimes you're not. And you say, I know it's got to be in the newspaper, but you just can't figure out what word they used to, put from the headline. So I'll work on that and see what I can come up with. And maybe give some examples too.
Yeah, so. Finding aid for that is a great idea, Mary.
Okay.
Yes.
A lot of work though.
Well, and I think that like with the Confederate names, we had an end date and an end product. But this, I think of this as it's open-ended, and what we put out is the beginning, and we can add to or adjust as we go on. So that's just a thought, because it's a very different. There's so many aspects of it and so many layers to it, but it's not just names. So the resource we're dealing with cultural resources, and they are of the Black history, the Black communities, and they come in, and it's in all forms, all kinds of forms. So I think it's
going to be thousands of entries.
Yes.
That we're finding.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. So if we can, and as we do this, always ensure wherever it's appropriate to say that this is something that's ongoing and building.
Mm-hmm.
So.
So is the next step to figure out what order these are, or will you, Mary and Phyllis, will you guys do that, is figure out what order, like merge these together and then just give us the definitive order or send us an Excel template, and then we can all just start filling that out as we did for Confederate names.
Oh, I hate Excel templates.
I know, I do too.
I like Word.
I'm sorry I said that, because I hate it.
We work in Word. Is that okay?
So the template can be, I would think, could be in Word rather than trying to work in an Excel template. And Chris can correct me if I'm wrong, because I thought, oh, I'm going to be so kind to Chris and Denise, and I'm going to do mine in Excel. And I think I made more work for them because
it was a challenge. It was a challenge.
I hate Excel.
The thought was good, but it did make it a little bit more difficult.
It actually made it more difficult, thinking that, because I thought that the end product would be an Excel table, but you guys didn't do an Excel table as your end product, did you?
Mm-mm. No.
Or did you do a very different one?
No, it was Word, classic Word.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So they wound up doing a word table, than Excel. So, I think, if we want our, Excel has value and merits, but if that isn't our end product, an Excel table, I don't know that there's an advantage in doing it in Excel to begin with.
What is the best end product?
Probably some kind of database, but and I don't think there'd be any advantage in putting it in Excel if we were going to eventually put it into a database. But the initial end product is just going to be these lists. It's just going to be these.
Right.
That's right. It's the list. It's identifying. Here it is. This is the core of it. This is this part of the history that's here. It is, and then decide from there.
Right. Yeah,
I mean, we might have to. I should probably sit down and talk to Thomas, who is our webmaster, and see what he thinks in terms of how this works. I mean, I know that he's going to talk about databases, and I'm not going to. None of us knows how to use a database. So
I think for a long time.
If we do a subcommittee to figure out what the final would be, and so that means that you would talk to Thomas, we'd talk to Chris, And I know that Chris and Jeff Clark have worked on some projects that have databases. So maybe three or four of you could get together and talk about what it is.
I'm a host
Our
now.
Template would be in Word, and how do we take that to a final product that we can then post on the website?
That makes a lot of sense.
I don't know if you've heard anything different, but I know at the Park Authority, they've been talking to us about possibly no longer supporting access as a database. Have you heard anything about that as a county, at the county level?
I haven't heard anything about that, but I would not use Access. That's horrible. It's a terrible, terrible database. Everybody hates it. The county actually has it's called SQL. That would be probably what we would end up in.
The only thing I'm asking, Cheryl, is though, can you use SQL on a county computer?
That's what is set up on county computers. You can access that from your office. It's part of
that. We have access. That's why I'm asking.
Yeah, we do.
Because all of our archaeological databases are set up in Access.
Oh, are they in Access?
All of the millions of artifacts are all in Access. And we're very concerned about, the ultimate transfer.
Oh, yes. Liz, I don't know anything about that, I don't want to prejudge where our subcommittee would be going, but I doubt very much that we would wind up with Access as a solution, because IT people universally hate it. And for good reason. I've tried using it and it's horrible. It's kudos to you to figuring it out, Liz.
I'm going back to what Tammy said. First of all, we need to get our lists. And have a list, and we can put it out as a list, and then you all work, those techies can do that. When Liz says that, when county archaeology came to the Park Authority, one of the big problems was that the county archaeology lists data was in one format and the Park Authority was in another, and it took literally years to figure out how you could merge them. This is pre-Liz time, and it was just awful. So I'm happy to have the ideas. I am not a techie person. I'm the wrong generation. So you all go and do it.
Okay. So the actual template.
Or the Carol, I think, was saying something.
Well, this is Carol. If someone would send me an email that has everybody's email address on it, that's on the committee, I will forward you kind of what I've written, because I'm sort of pretty much finished, and it kind of lists everything, and you can just kind of see what I've done, and we can stick it on a template or whatever we want to do. But if somebody has that list, they can just forward me some old email. I'll forward this to you.
Great. Thank you.
Okay.
I was going to ask Liz Kroll, because we're looking at this, are there any artifacts in the cultural resources that we need to include in templates?
I think that would be, we can talk about sites maybe.
Okay.
Whatever, but I think if we start, we can talk about certain places, but that could become pretty overwhelming.
Okay. I just know at one time we had thought about adding that to the template, and I didn't know.
No, I'm not saying we can't add some. I'm not sure how, we can approach the low-hanging fruit, but there are some collections that say were done 20, 25 years ago that things may not have been identified as they should have been.
Okay.
Well, if you're thinking of the little beads that are down at the at Natural History, at least they were. You think of that. You think of the
Crowley
ware, things that we know.
Yeah.
And that examples.
Absolutely that kind of stuff. I just meant in going back, there are certain things from some of our older collections that I'm pretty sure are associated with African-American occupation of the properties, but they weren't identified that way, and we might have to go back and do some reanalysis.
Well, Liz, what I was thinking about is the John Hawthorne in our neighborhood picked up a piece of the fencing around the slave cemetery from the Ravensworth plantation, and it was in Lake Accotink's little display. My understanding is now in cultural resources because they moved everything from Lake Accotink. He's the one who identified it. See, that's what I'm trying to think in terms of getting into the weeds here. It's based on his oral history that we know from him that that was around the slave cemetery. So I don't know how, if we wanted to present that, how it would be presented.
Right. If there's anything like that that you know of, Mary, send me an email.
Okay.
Let me talk to my folks and find out what the status of that is.
Okay.
Because, like, if there was anything in that display or whatever.
All right.
That is weeks, but I mean, you could just put the oral history, and then within the oral history is a reference to it.
Yeah, because he described.
Of course, there is the oral history that's telling you what this is. By itself, it doesn't, right?
Right. Phyllis, were we going to talk about multiple things with the same name? How are we doing?
Yes. Okay. Yes.
Well, a little bit of that was done with
your example, Mary, was Little Zion, the church, right. The cemetery, and the site. Yeah. To me, that's all goes together under community, Little Zion community, and then under that, that's my approach. What would you think?
Well, it would not have been called Little Zion though, because it's the Burke is the community, and the church is part of that community. So I don't know. Maybe I'm just getting too specific here, but. I don't think anybody would say, well, that's from the Little Zion community. It's from the Burke community.
Well, then understand under.
See, I have your site. Okay.
When you go down under community name, and then you get down to the resources, which is what, so you'd have the church, the cemetery, okay, right. Whatever. Those all go together because they're all in the.
Okay,
right?
That's fine.
This is just my approach. Anybody else can.
Yeah.
But okay.
Well, I thought it would be that way because I didn't think you would do a separate template.
I think they should be put together, but I just wanted to see how we were going to organize it.
I think Cheryl had the right idea. We just have to try it. Experiment. So Phyllis, who's going to be on your subcommittee?
On my subcommittee?
You're in Mary's subcommittee.
Okay.
You're talking the techie committee?
Mm-hmm.
Well, so we know Cheryl
has to be.
Yeah, I think it's going to be Cheryl. Although it does sound
like Chris. Chris is being really quiet. Chris, would you be on this committee?
That's fine. Yeah, my knowledge of databases only goes so far, but I'd be happy to help out.
Now, we're just asking questions, Chris, because, you know, other than saying cool things like SQL, that's as far as I go.
and that's actually just a way to communicate with the database, not a database. Now, I don't know that this will help or not, and I'm not sure I want to be on the committee, but my daughter is a historian, and she does databases, and she did the Mao Legacy Project and some other things, so I can kind of pick her brain about something simple enough and easy enough for us to use. But, you know, she's like way up there, and I'm down here on that.
You could do it whether you're on the committee or not. That would be great.
We want to know.
But she has done that. She worked at the Mason Center for History and New Media before she got her PhD and everything, and now does this stuff for a living. So she might be able to help us a little.
Oh, she'd be really good.
Yeah.
I'm sending her an email right now.
Because Mason's resources, Mason actually has databases that are designed to work with exhibit materials. I mean, I don't know that it particularly applies to us in terms of what we're collecting, because we're collecting, even if it's a reference to an oral history or a reference to a website, what we're collecting is ultimately text. But George Mason has things where you can put up pictures and photographs of artifacts, and usually databases have a hard time incorporating graphic elements like that, but they've designed databases for that purpose. George Mason has.
And they're right here, and they answer questions, which is really important for us. And I do know that in Alexandria, we are quote unquote looking, and Gretchen, of course, would just, you know, slip my throat if I said this, but we're looking at what they have at Mason to do something like that for Freedom House eventually, with everything that's coming in.
Yeah.
But we're like on the first step of that. But they're right here, and they know what we do, and they're doing that kind of stuff for other people. So that's a real good place to start.
Well, we need the basic does Tammy have time?
My database information is very, very old. So I don't know if that would be helpful.
Well, I can contact George Mason, the Center for History and New Media, and see what they have.
Way back when we were doing Braddock's True Gold, they helped us with an intern that actually worked with the whole project, getting the oral histories and setting up the website and all of that. So there may be someone who's looking for a type of internship. That's a possibility too.
Yeah.
Mason actually has, for their IT program, they have a capstone requirement for seniors. They have to do a project, a real project that's hands-on and, you know, does something for somebody. So so that's always a resource. The real difficulty is going to be dovetailing it with whatever the county requires.
Yes.
We can come up with all sorts of really exciting and interesting ideas, but the question is, will the county support it?
Well, if you like how the cemetery database is set up on the library's webpage or the historic newspaper index, those are all built from Access databases, which I think were converted to Excel. They're not very visually exciting, but all the text is there. They're all text-based databases. Mm-hmm. And that's something that the county created for us.
So I think that, I mean, that's something that we could talk to, and I'm not sure who we would really speak with in the county. Thomas would just sort of be the starting point because he is our website webmaster. But you know, he could say, yeah, sure, you know, so and so will do a database for you, but you need, you know, maybe that will cost us something, which is fine, you know. Again, it sort of depends on what we want in terms of that final project product. If you want snazzier, you know, images and things like that, then George Mason would be more of a resource potentially.
Okay, so Sue's going to check with her daughter. I'm going to check with George Mason. Cheryl's going to check with Thomas. And Chris is telling us what he knows that he works with. So
yeah,
I'm
finding out from my daughter who would be the best person to talk to there. She worked when Roy Rosenzweig was still director, but she has kept in touch with all of them because she's worked for a Stanford project and some other stuff. So yeah, I'll let you know the name.
Okay. Thank you. So we think we're good with what we are going forward with for the what the final product will be. And if we're comfortable with that, then we can move into talking about our presence at the Fairfax County History Commission conference in November.
Can I ask a question first?
Yes.
This is all great, but again, what we're looking for, the template to begin with is one thing, and then what we do with it in making it into the database is the second step, correct? Mm-hmm. Is that right?
Yes.
So
yes.
So we're going to work on a merger sort of Mary's suggestion in mind and have that as a template for this raw information, whatever you want. I'm not going to use the word data, the raw, the stories, the material, the information, the history.
Recorded,
however it's recorded. If it's a tombstone, it's recorded. And if it's oral history, it's recorded. Correct? This is for me to make sure. And then from then we go into how we're going to, after we've identified it, which is what we're doing, this is it's an identification, then we go into how we're going to
package it.
Yeah.
How it's packaged on the website.
Okay.
Right. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we can always just sort of do what we did with Confederate names. I mean, that's always the option, and it won't be searchable, you know, and all that. Or I'm sure actually the Confederate names report is searchable. You just need to go Control F and you can search it. So you just, you know, at minimum we can do that. We just create a report and we put it on the website. But you know, we might be able to do something fancier. But I think you're right, Barbara, in terms of the priority is the template and getting the data collected. That's what we need to focus on first.
Right.
And in terms of the difference between yours and Mary's, the key difference that I see is that Mary has columns and yours is written out as lines.
Y'all figure.
And Carol's already done hers. So
and then Carol's going to send hers. So.
Yeah.
For some reason I'm having a problem, but it's coming.
Good. Thank you, Carol.
Cheryl, I'll send you the email list when we get up. After the meeting.
Let's see if it'll go.
I'm going to suggest in the looking at how we're working on things, if Phyllis and I take the two or three together, come up with one, and then say, this is what we're going to use.
This is it.
If that's agreeable with everyone.
Sure.
You've seen the ideas of everybody. This is just a template. This is just gathering information. It's not saying how it's going to go on the website or anything like that. Just so, because I've been holding off starting Braddock District because I don't want to do it twice.
Me too.
So I want to see what we, you know. So if you all will trust Phyllis and me that we'll take it and get it back to you. Let's say Phyllis within 2 weeks. Can we do that, Phyllis? And then that's the go ahead. When you get it from us, you can go ahead with that. Okay.
That'd be great.
You guys,
we're set.
Carol sent us. This is wonderful, Carol. Sent us her list.
Some of them came back. So you got one. Okay.
I got mine.
And those of us with only one screen like mine can't see it till the meeting's over.
And many of them came back for, like, Christopher Lipsy's came back. I don't know why. Phyllis's came back, and it's her email address. But anyway, Anne, if you could forward that to everybody. Do you have the list? Who has a list?
I have so many screens. I will just do that, Carol.
And then you'll shoot me.
Okay.
Remember to use BCC so that the FOIA police don't come get you.
Right. I am Please. So good at BCC, and in fact, that's our whole problem with this. If we had some nice email that went to all of us, we would just use that. But since everybody's been so super at BCC, there's no one email list for this committee. Isn't that interesting? We're so good.
So it's Phyllis and Mary for that. And then for the techies, we have Cheryl, we have Chris, and we have Sue, we have Phyllis. But that group is going to do whatever they are to decide how we're going to handle it for putting it out officially. Is that right?
Right. And I'm going to check in with everybody on that subcommittee. Okay. Okay, we
thank you.
It's now 3:24 and we need to get into what is our participation on the history conference? We said that we wanted to have a presence for our committee at the history conference. And Lynn has started contacting people for speakers for the conference. So the first half of the conference, the morning portion of the conference, has already been set with Native Americans. She has for the second half of the conference, which would be after lunch, which runs from 1:15 until around 3:30. For that portion, she started out with securing Ron Chase with Gum Springs Museum. And Ron is going to be presenting from the museum. And he has, I believe it's 20 minutes that he will be discussing the community, the first community, African-American community in Fairfax County. And then we can go from there. You know, I think it would be good if we could showcase some of what we're collecting or what we're finding in our research that we're doing with the African American Initiative. So
I think it would be great to introduce the idea, you know, of, mm-hmm. of what we're doing and how it got started, and then maybe give a few examples that are very different in nature that kind of show the scope. You know, here's a building, here's a cemetery, here's a document, you know, just things that are very different in nature.
Phyllis and I and Mary and I talked about this a little bit. And one idea, again, if you look at some of the communities, Gum Spring, yes, but then it's like, you know, the Pleasant Grove Church, which is there near where Audrick's Corner was, and that's the church and the cemetery, and there's a connection there because of the Pamunkey Indian. And if you look at Carrollton, what you have is the big marker, but you also have the history of Carrollton, which is down South County. And then in Vienna, you have a Black community there. And then Phyllis thought, and this is because Mary wasn't there, or she would have thought, the oral history, the one that was just done, would be fantastic because the young woman could perhaps come the West Springfield. She'll have graduated, but I think maybe she still will be in Virginia at school and could come and present, do a summary of her oral history interview, because the oral, that's part of our project, part of our initiative too. And I was really excited about that because Phyllis, did you say the woman she interviewed was connected with Bailey's
conference? They've interviewed, the two students from West Springfield interviewed, I believe it's seven people, Mary. We both submitted five names each, and then some of mine dropped out. One person died, one person got COVID. So I think we're ending up with seven interviews that the students did. And there it's a variety of people that they've actually had the opportunity to interview. One of them grew up in the Bailey's Crossroads area, and she was a Fairfax County, she's a retired Fairfax County educator who I think her last job was as an assistant principal in the county. But she and her brothers, or I think it's three brothers, grew up in the Mason District area.
What do you all think? I was really excited about it.
I think it's a really good idea to have that student who did the oral history also bridge the generations and let us know that we are looking for younger people to get involved with this And, you know, more short snippets of things and the kind of things that we can do make sense. Also, we were hoping that at the end of the history conference, this history marker contest that Mary and I are working on, you know, with the Providence District Supervisor could segue into that for next year, because the school year is when that will be, you know, part of the curriculum. We are hoping, we'll find out Friday what teachers think of this. But yeah, kind of at the end of the conference.
We could put that. Yeah, we could add forward. That. It's sort of like this is looking forward, and that includes the students.
That's not like an end, and then, you know, we do have 4 years to kind of explore all this, so we'll let people know that.
This is Esther. That's sorry, good. I'm late. Sue, what did you have in mind, just announcing that it's coming?
Well, after the oral history project and after the student interview, to say, yeah, just a few minutes, here's what's going to happen. And for those of you who have students or an interest in this, you know, kind of put it out there to the whole community at the end of the conference. So it's not a final thing, it's not an end.
Which would be let people know this is ongoing. Yeah. And I don't know whether I mean, the presentations would not be long. They would be, you know, summaries of these different communities as examples.
That's exactly what
history. Mm-hmm.
That's exactly it. That's just one big heavy thing. Yeah. But
no. The thing that's so exciting about this proposal to cover a number of different communities is we're going to learn. Everybody's going to learn so much. You're not learning about one community or one sort of big amorphous effort. You're actually going to have time to spend a few minutes on places that we might not know much about. And right. And it obviously can't be the exhaustive list, but it's really going to spark a lot of interest for people to see and learn about. Like, how many are you thinking you could fit in an afternoon, Barbara?
Well, I don't know. We were talking about if you look at the time, we were trying to work with the time that's allotted, and we were and Ron would be the first, but Phyllis would talk with him to make sure that he's, you know, and because he'd be videoed, then it, you know, it'll be a limited maybe 15, 20 minutes max. And so the others would be no more than like 15 minutes. Which is plenty of time to just to tell the story of the community.
Mm-hmm. How much time is allowed?
Pardon me?
How much time is allowed?
Well, the whole.
That's what we're not sure. We know that the afternoon is from 1:15 to about 3:30. And I'm going to be talking with Lynn tomorrow afternoon at 3 about what we possibly could do.
Yeah, and we
if you're looking at each person having about 10 minutes, and if it's a virtual conference, you still have time. You'd still have to work with what Channel 16 would have to do in terms of in between speakers,
right?
Or panel.
Have you done oral histories of other communities, or just the student with the Mason District?
Well, this is the oral history would just be one session, because Carrollton is the story of the community, and the details there came from the new marker. Pleasant Grove is a fascinating story, and they're still working on the marker there, but that church and cemetery are still there. Mm-hmm. Vienna, I will let Ann talk to that, but I mean, that's a long-standing.
Vienna has First Baptist, I'm a member. First Baptist with cemetery.
Right.
In fact, I think we had more than one, but one is still functioning.
Yeah. So the idea, I think, my sense is that we're showing the different quote, community, the different forms, and then we'd end up with the young woman talking about the interview that she did, which is oral history, and then that would be great to lead into our the children's marker. So
I would love to introduce the audience to the Manassas Industrial School, because I believe a lot of our audience has no idea of
how
African Americans could not get a high school education in their own county.
Well, if you do that, you need to also talk about going to Washington to go to school.
Well, that's true.
Those were the two opportunities they had to choose from, and it was difficult going to either one without transportation.
Right. Some of them went to Alexandria also, but just that information, whether it's done through someone who experienced it or whatever, but I mean, it opened my eyes, and I grew up in this county and had no idea, you know, that was the only way that the education was available for many.
A whole hour on that.
Oh, I know. Well, maybe that's one thing I suggested to Lynn, that you could do a whole conference just on education.
Oh, yeah.
So maybe that'd be for another future conference. Anyway.
Well, it just gives an example here as we're talking of all of the different things we could choose from to make it rich. And I think for our audience would be, I think, to me, the point is, This is what our initiative is discovering. All right, we have communities all over the county, and this is no two are the same, but we're telling about them so that there's an awareness.
Could we possibly do this as a panel, in that you pose a certain question about a community? Introduce it, first of all, saying what the communities were and where they were, but then pose a question to someone from two or three of those communities.
I think you could do that if you had more time, but if we've only got an afternoon, I feel like people might start to get them mixed up. I leave my little Wikipedia paragraph on each one so that I can kind of really absorb each one. I think we should do a panel for this sort of thing, because it's the most thrilling way to tell it, but it might be
too much.
We'll get other opportunities in future conferences. I don't know. We can't do everything at one conference.
Right. And maybe oral history needs its own presentation.
Mm-hmm. Well, and David, you had something to say.
Yeah.
Oh, I was just going to go down an esoteric little footnote to the vocational school in Manassas. The history of that school is really about a woman named Jenny Dean. Most of you probably already know the story, and her efforts in the 1890s to actually create that school. And when the school was on its opening ceremonies, it was a big deal. Frederick Douglass was there, U.S. Senator was there, Clara Barton was still alive, and she was there at the ceremony. At that point, she was the president of the National Red Cross. So it was an integrated group of people, and I think there's a real story just in and of that to tell, which was sort of a counterpoint to a lot of really negative trends that were going on at the same time.
Interesting.
That's all I was going to
say. I didn't know that.
It was a big deal.
1894.
Okay.
But when we talk about the history conference, I'm a member of the committee, as some of you are maybe, and the afternoon had been broken up. So I think we need to find a time factor, because I'm seeing a certain allotment of time.
Well, I think Phyllis is meeting with Lynn tomorrow, and our idea is to take that time and put this program, these program thematics into that time slot.
Okay, so say if we had an hour.
Well, go ahead, Phyllis.
From what Lynn sent out, she has Ron Chase as the lead off for the afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
And he has, I believe it's approximately 20 minutes, but she needs to finalize the rest of the day, which is a time frame. If Ron starts at 1:15 and he goes for 20 minutes, the time that's left has not been filled yet.
Right.
At least according to the last update that Lynn sent out. So yeah. What I was going to do is I'm going to be talking with her tomorrow at 3:00 to see what part we could interject some of the AAHI.
Mm-hmm.
Resources that we found.
I also know that we might, because I was talking with Liz for the morning with the Native American Legacy and Archaeology. Those two together are not going to take as much time as was originally allotted. So that pushes, we may gain some time and lunch would be a little earlier. So that lets the afternoon be a little longer. So nothing's, as I understand, totally locked in, right, per se to the times. And I think that Phyllis brought up an interesting point. A panel is great, but if we're still in, depending upon what the protocols are, even for a virtual program, can they all sit together, or is it better to, you know, how do you handle the individual presenters? So yeah, those are questions that whether they would be individual, you know, minis, but not all.
Well, I think there was sort of a panel last year, yes, like during Esther's time. I feel like there was a
yes,
panel that had like several people with in different locations, maybe.
Each person yeah, spoke from a different location. They were not sitting together. Mm-hmm. I interviewed and they spoke from their own location.
Okay, I see. Yeah.
So if you had one topic at a time, you could present it and have each of whoever's there to speak on that topic, just answer a question, not go into a great deal of discussion, and then go to another segment. You know, and that would get you more content.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's kind of what I'm thinking of. And even if we had 2 hours in the afternoon, which might be what we end up having there, I mean, even if we had as much as that, I still feel like that's only going to be enough time for highlights, like overview yeah, of AAHI. AAHI. I can't say that. Overview of AAHI and then highlights. Just, I think exactly, that's all we're going to have time for. Yeah. Even, mm-hmm, I mean, it'll go that's, fast.
But that's good because we have it. The keynote is you know, I think the economics of slavery. That's part of the morning. So we have some longer sessions. So this is just like a snapshot of what we're about, and here's some examples. And that yeah, to me is yeah, exciting. And then you can conclude yeah, with the. You know, we are interviewing people. Maybe some people will end up volunteering. We'd like to tell our stories and we will end yes, up having four or
that's a great idea. Plug for interview, like tell you
absolutely, your favorite person. Make it more people.
Yes.
So if you could flash four things, what would those four categories be? If you want to highlight oral history, highlight a marker.
What was your community like? What was your, I don't want to say family day-to-day, but something that would bring out the flavor of the community and what it was like for the person.
Maybe what were the central like gathering places for the community, whether they be churches or other things like that.
That's a good one.
That's good.
Because like schools, if there's a central place in a community, if it's a church, if it's a general store where people meet, you know, or some kind of a, you know, I can't think of the right name, but like an organization.
There are halls where the men have gotten together, like a Masonic hall.
Masons.
Exactly. Yeah, in Vienna, I know.
Right.
And yeah, because I was thinking the Odd Fellows Hall.
Yeah. Yeah, I was thinking something like that.
Mm-hmm.
That's good.
I don't think Tammy has the right idea that we've got to really focus on a few things.
Right.
Hammer down on those.
Well, because education, as you spoke earlier, right, is important. So what was it like going to school? Did you, were you able to attend grades 1 through 12 in your community? That kind of thing that would bring out the Manassas school.
Right.
And that draws the interest of multiple age, like kids are really interested in, you know, what happened during different times. And then also, you know, older people will be fascinated by that also.
It might be that one of the, I mean, like if you're talking about Carrollton, this is something that existed. Now we have a marker, but it tells the history of that community. But if one of the sessions, one little group was the community of Manassas Industrial School, and you just had that as one of the groups by itself, one of the, you can call that a community, but then you could tell this wonderful story that David just shared and have that as one of the ones we put forth.
Okay, information about the fair. Mary, we're looking that up.
Yeah, I haven't gotten to the library, but it's in the historical, Fairfax County Historical Society yearbook, and I used it as a source. And there are also newspaper articles.
Yeah. It's in the Netherton book too, Mary.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
And
programs from that.
Right, right. And it's a big deal for the communities.
It was a form of entertainment.
Right, the whole family, my understanding is the whole family participated, not just young people, you know, et cetera. So the county fair was an important thing. Manassas Industrial School, I think you could pick up a church, one of the churches. If there are any people who belong to the Sons and Daughters, or an Odd Fellows, and that would give a flavor of your education, church, community activity, you know, to give a flavor of what we're learning about what Fairfax County was like.
Mm-hmm.
That would be four items. I think that would be plenty. You know, if we could get 10 minutes maybe on each one of those with either, you know, someone speaking about it or saying, you know, we have found this information and say, you know, Mary Smith said such and such about, you know, attending the county fair or whatever.
Okay. So that would be Jenny Dean.
Manassas Industrial School. Yeah, county fair, a county organization, whether it's, you know, one of these either Odd Fellows, Sons and Daughters, or the Colored Citizens Association, which I'll look up and find out if I can find out more information about that, and then a church.
So you got the church. The oldest church.
Yeah.
Or a church.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's a good idea. Those are good ideas, Mary.
So that's,
well, that's, if you go to First Baptist of Vienna, the establishment of the school had the elementary school that's across the street.
Louise Archer.
Louise Archer, yes, I couldn't think. Louise Archer is actually from that First Baptist school. And then you have I don't know if it's Odd Fellows or what it's called, but you have a lodge next door to that school.
Yeah.
What's that? Elks. It's Elks.
Isn't it? Okay. Yeah, Elks. So you have quite a bit right in that area.
Right.
Okay.
And of course, if you go to Pleasant Grove area, you've got quite a bit right there with the church and the museum.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. I think we've got enough, and I will talk with Lynn tomorrow. We're scheduled to meet at 3, so I can make these suggestions, and then our committee would work on who will actually be doing each of these pieces.
I think it's rich. We have lots to choose from.
Yeah, we've got more than enough to choose from.
Yes, ma'am.
That's why I said this committee needs its own presentation.
Well, let's go one step at a time.
Yeah. Right. And there's still a lot that we could present. Yeah.
Right, right. There's still a lot to uncover.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
This is exciting. This is the first step of letting the public know.
Right.
What we're doing.
Which might garner some interest enough to want to participate.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Just a comment that there's also history out here in Western Fairfax too. There's some Cub Run Colored School. There's the school that preceded that was over closer to, you know, that was on Harris property, the whole gatepost Cub Run community there. That also could, you know, schools in general are really important.
Depending on each. Depending on the time slot that Lynn has, then we may be able to add more.
Right. Mm-hmm. If we just have the entire afternoon, we can fit a lot in there.
Well, there's also, and this is again something that the audience may not know about the Freedman. I mean, I'm talking not after the Civil War, even before the Civil War.
Before the Civil War.
Samuel Sharper of the Pleasant Grove was a free man, you know, who was a trustee for that church. You have the Carter community and Harris community in the Centerville area, right, who were free. And so that's, I mean, you're getting my history, but I really want to get it out and get everybody to know this. But that's something that just could be introduced, you know.
But if you're talking about, if you end up choosing Pleasant Grove, then that's part of the Pleasant Grove story.
Right, it is.
And so you're fitting it into a larger context so that they,
I think Lynn's initial idea was to actually have a panel discussion with representatives from these different communities, descendants, and you know, and then talk about these different things.
It wasn't necessarily a descendant, but a person that knows knows the story either because of a descendant or some connection, so that they could talk to it.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So, well, Phyllis, do you have enough stuff?
I have enough for 3 o'clock tomorrow. Yes, and then some.
We need a day.
if you all remember,
we need a week.
We voted as a committee that we wanted to have a presence here, and that we suggested the afternoon because we knew the morning was locked into the Native American heritage. And so I think we're following through on that, and we have really excellent ideas. So
I'm going to suggest something even more radical, that the History Commission could branch out and do a quarterly, not conference, but just a program that people could sign into, and we could share the stories, you know. I mean, because the Burke Historical Society is very good at this, and having speakers, you know, each month come in and talk about all sorts of stuff. But again, it doesn't have to be a conference, but then it's available through our website or whatever, that just quarterly there would be a speaker that would speak on something, either, you know, from our county and start with African Americans, etc.
That's an excellent idea. That's excellent. Mary.
Well, look at
it. Like the advocacy committee.
There we go.
Exactly what I was thinking. Exactly what I was thinking. I mean, it's programmatic. It's all of us. And if we do it all by Zoom, we don't have to find a venue. Woo! you know.
If you choose a calendar, like, you know, the Berks Historical Society is always the last Sunday of the month. If you set up a calendar, then you get an audience. Oh yeah, it's the second whatever of the month. And right. The History Commission is going to have a program, and I'm going to tune in.
Wonderful way, just the way Fairfax City does.
I was about to say, look at what Fairfax City and David's doing there every Thursday night. Mm-hmm. So
right.
Well, and yeah. Look at how Historic Blenheim and the Fairfax Museum have been doing it for years and years.
Right.
So you know you've got this whatever Sunday it is, and the second Saturday you can set your calendar by it. Quarterly is a little harder.
Great idea.
Yeah. Great it's idea. Really good, Mary.
And yeah, we have the talent. We have the talent on the History Commission to do this. You know,
we can go back to our Speakers Bureau.
Yep.
And we definitely have the information. We have lots of history to tell.
Right.
Well, let's remember this as we go. We'll be whatever we can't fit into this conference is prime, or can't fit in to this conference in any more than 5 minutes is a prime candidate for being in one of these quarterly programs.
Yes, for sure.
Mm-hmm. Good.
Okay. I will let everybody know. What?
Good luck.
I come Good up luck. With when Lynn tomorrow. Does anybody else have anything else to want to bring up before we close?
No, good work.
Thank you. Thank you. Everybody for all you're doing. It's great. It's exciting.
I think I got everybody just sort of a rough draft that I've done for Drainsville. But okay. If I let anybody out, I'm sorry.
Thank you, Carol.
Thanks, Carol.
Okay, I'm just looking at the meeting. Yeah, June 8th. Is that it?
Yes.
June 8th.
June 8th at 2:30.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. 2:30. Okay.
And so we will try to get minutes out to you within the next week.
I hope I've done my best. It's hard to write and talk, and I simply cannot keep my mouth shut. So
that's okay, Barbara.
Okay.
Thank you, Barbara.
Sorry, Mary and Phyllis, that I'm late. I had a mammogram and they went late on the schedule.
Oh,
okay. Well, we're glad you made it.
I understand.
Thank you.
Good for you.
Thanks,
for doing
Esther.
It. Okay. I want to thank Barbara for doing this.
You shouldn't thank me till you see what they're like.
All right. And David, I'll answer you offline. I saw what you had in the chat.
So. Okay, that's fine.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Very good. Bye. Thank you.
Bye.